Hi, everybody, and welcome to this SportsCentre Top 10 special. I'm Darren Dutchyshen. Well, you may love them if they're on your team, but even then, it can be difficult. They are the ugly children of the NHL. They are instigators, aggravators, and agitators, and they do have a role to play during the course of the next half hour. We're going to count down the best of the best. We begin with Clear the Track for Eddie Shack.
Eddie Shack, you know, who would, really stir it up.
He was a fan favorite in Toronto and a guy that would tick off the other team.
Well, we've got something going here.
I remember the one particular game against St. Louis. He was bugging the playgroup others, and they all kind of ganged up on him and basically attacked him.
Bob Kelly was after him all over the ice, Goldie. Well, there was more than Bob Kelly after him. Two or three of them wanted to take a shot at him.
And he came flying to the Leaf bench, jumped behind everybody, and they were out in front of us like a pack of wolves ready to get at him.
Discretion, the better part of valor there with the posse after him, headed for the safety of the bench.
And Shaq at this time is sitting on the Leaf bench and smiling through it all.
Got to the point where too many guys wanted to have a shot at just one guy.
Tucker low-bridged him.
Darcy Tucker is another guy that plays the game on the edge.
Wasn't quite as dirty a hit as I thought it was.
He'd stare right at you. There's 175, 180 pound soaking wet guy throwing everything at you. Elbows, hands, feet, you name it, he's going to try to win.
We had some great battles, some great on-ice verbal stuff that was nasty.
Darcy Tucker and Matthew Barnaby.
His alter ego.
It's like looking in the mirror, Matthew.
He's definitely a guy that can stir the pot.
Tucker's got everybody watching him here tonight.
Would you calm down? Would you settle to like your game number five of an 80-game season? And he's throwing everything at you like this, and you're...
In order to play in the National Hockey League, you had to play with a lot more edge. And I think he just created more of that role for himself to give himself a little space to try and do the things that he did as a junior.
Darcy was a guy that stuck his nose in there and got in the fight.
Tucker and Pekka are really teeing off on each other back at center ice.
He liked to talk and get in your face and at face-offs and whatnot. And, he came to play.
Even when the fight's over on the ice, he continues it verbally.
Tucker and Neil are continuing with the discussion, and Darcy's getting rather animated about it.
When he hits somebody, he hits, he agitates, he stays in the scrums, and he's just waiting for that other player to take another, to bite on it, to take another minor penalty.
Tempers flare, and Tucker goes into the goalie.
He dove once, pretended I speared him, and had to fight somebody for that. And then the next time I played against him in Tampa, I think I might have hit him over the head with my stick, and cost me a little bit of money from the league, but so I guess he did his job.
Dirty, mean, in my opinion, he was the best at it.
And look at Hunter, trying to get a gash and being held back.
Oh, tell me, Hunter's in the middle of it. What a surprise.
Everybody wanted to kill him.
He was physical. He would really get things going. His team would be down a few goals. He'd get in people's faces, and he would really stir it up. And I knew I was bigger than he was, and I knew I could, I could model myself after a guy like him.
He was my line mate my first year in the National Hockey League. If the score became 5-1 for either team, it was time to get things going. You get a little nudge from Huntsie, and he'd tell you, we're not going down without a fight in this one. Huntsie knew what he was doing.
He committed himself to do things that a lot of people just don't have the stomach for.
Everybody remembers the dubious hit on Turgeon.
There's a giveaway. Turgeon scores!
Hunter was frustrated for giving the puck up. Now watch this. Oh, he just lost it.
I didn't see the puck go in the net. I took a quick look, too, and I did not see it go in the net. Just as I was in it, he raised his arms up in the air. If I could take it back, I would, because he did score, I guess.
I still watch it to this day, and I keep thinking, what was he thinking? Other than, I'm going to drill this guy into the shoulder. It's like playing street hockey and not liking what happened. You take the tennis ball and you rifle it down the street, or you rifle it at somebody. That's kind of his mentality. I think that's the way he played.
He was the guy we loved to hate. What he put into the game and the effort that he put in day in and day out to be a pest.
I remember him facing off with Eric Lindros once and telling Lindros that better keep his head up or he's going to take his eye out, because he didn't care anymore and he wasn't going to play again the next year. And Lindros's eyes just lit up, and Huntsie gave a big wink over to me and had a big chuckle about it at the end of the night.
Playing the Islanders, Smitty was waiting. Billy Smith was one of the guys that he used a stick like it was a machete and he was going to chop you right now.
The only trouble is, Smitty, you broke your stick off.
He was a clutch goaltender, and, you know, when we're playing the Stanley Cup final, there are no friends. You play to win. You do whatever it takes to become a champion, and that's what he had in him.
Billy Smith, yeah, he was a guy that didn't really want to get too close to in and around the front of his net because he was pretty good with the stick.
He'd get me behind the net. If I came around the net, he'd swing his stick. But, hey, listen, he was doing what he could to become a champion.
As a kid growing up watching, especially those great Islander teams, he knew he was a major part of their success. And he really fed off his battle readiness. I mean, he just was such a tiger in the goal. And he would drive other guys nuts. He knew what the rules were.
He took it as far as he possibly could. And that much I noticed about Billy Smith. And that's something that I kind of learned and watched, was the fact he took the rules to their utmost maximum is what he's going to get away with.
Billy has that, you know, he had that knob that was exposed too, huh? So he has that tape was down 4 inches. So that he had the wooden knob just sitting there, so he could get the stick around and butt end it. It was a dangerous. Oh, he knew it. I mean, that's. So the rule came about afterwards that the knob of the goalie stick had to go to the very end of the shaft. So that was the Billy Smith rule. But he was good. He was sneaky.
Coming up, he's so good at getting the opposition off their game. Sometimes his own teammates can't even take him.
He does make you want to kill him.
Sean Avery's at his best as hockey's top 10 agitators continues with the top 6 next. Well, welcome back to the show. I could listen to Keith Jones tell Dale Hunter stories all day. Now, this next instigator didn't just ride the line. He really went over it. Claude Lemieux took the Detroit-Colorado rivalry, and in one single play, he turned it into a war. It was ugly and uncalled for, and there was payback. Claude Lemieux, the player they called Pepe Le Pew, is number 6.
Mission, get under the other team's skin. Nobody does it better than Claude Lemieux.
He could get you going pretty quick. He would do things out there that would kind of upset you.
It was very easy to dislike him.
Still, Turpin still in the face.
I think he's going to attack our cameraman.
He just aggravated everybody, you know, and he would play hard, but then, you know, he'd lie on the ice and fake he was injured, and it was just enough to drive you nuts.
When I moved over to forward, I knew obviously what the defensemen didn't like to see and what they didn't like to see happening to them, and I just, you know, started getting under their skin and became sort of an agitator.
He was nasty with a stick. He would hit you whether you're facing him or whether your back was to him.
Waiting for his teammates to clear, Draper's hurt. He got leveled by Claude Lemieux, and he is down on the ice.
I've talked about that about 16,595 times.
Draper's cut and hurt, and Lemieux five and a game, and he's gone.
Look at me. You know, this is a hockey game, but look at my face. I can't believe I shook this guy's friggin' hand after the game. That pisses me right off.
I'll remember the Detroit series where they're just trying to attack him. They're just trying to get anywhere at him to kill him. You see, no one else matters on that ice except for trying to get at Claude Lemieux.
He always had something to say, you know, so, you know, I mean, if he wants to keep the thing alive, then, you know, we can do that.
Darren McCarty gets his shots in at Claude Lemieux.
It's done. It's passed. I played over 1,400 some games in the NHL. If I hit one guy sideways the wrong way one time, I had a pretty good career.
Sean's pretty good at getting in someone's kitchen.
Avery's been like sandpaper every time he's been on the ice.
He takes everything to the edge.
And of course, Sean Avery's always in the area.
He is nonstop.
Certainly not shy about what he has to say.
I think a guy who could be muzzled from time to time.
His nickname on the team in Detroit was Puppy, because he was sort of like that little puppy that sort of nips at your heels, and every once in a while you smack the puppy.
He's been vocal and babblative, as he usually is.
You could not skate by the Red Wings bench, or I'm sure the Rangers bench now. He will have something to say about your girlfriend, your mom, your wife. your long-lost cousin. He will find some way to get under your skin and drive you crazy.
He does make you want to kill him. I've wanted to kill him when I play there, so I know that's a good sign.
Sean really annoys all players in the NHL, and sometimes his own teammates too, in a fun way, and sometimes not so fun way.
Sometimes he goes overboard.
Call it tactics, call it antics. This is unbelievable. I've never seen anything like this.
It's just what he does, I guess. He wants you to engage in something.
I'm still going to be in everybody's face and causing a lot of trouble.
He has the attention of everybody out there. There's no question, and I quite frankly think he likes it that way.
Ken Linsman was the original Rat. You know, that was his nickname, Rat. Kenny the Rat Linsman.
He's going to stick his nose in even where it doesn't belong.
He could skate, he could talk, everything was... He could do everything fast. But that was the edge that he used to throw you off your game.
You name it, he did it. And he'd spear you, slash you, spit on you. He would get under your skin.
Linsman just speared Ian Duncan to the ice.
Linsman just looks on. Didn't seem to be too sorry for it, did he?
Him and I were near the bottom of the pile. I remember him trying to scratch at my eyes. So, you know, when your hands are tied up, all you can do is bite, right, to get him out of there. So I remember coming out of the pile and he's yelling at the ref, hey, he bit my finger. And then the ref looked at me and you could see my eyes were all scratched up. So he says, you're lucky you didn't bite it off.
It's one thing to be an agitator and get under people's skin, but Kenny Linsman was also a very effective player, and that just sort of burned people even more.
Still to come, one of the inventors of the role and one of the best in the game right now.
He infuriates guys. He'll say things that are cutthroat.
Hockey's top three agitators are next.